you off your game, but there may be some real challenges in this life, in this world, that may take you off your game and take your seed from you. You won't produce any fruit. Don't let that be the case. But don't let that be the case. And again, I see the cares of the world, you know, deceitfulness of riches. Boy, ain't that the truth? Like, you figure if you got a few bucks in the bank, I'm safe. No, you're not. Newsflash. My brother and I have had plenty of dollars in the bank. We weren't safe. They disappeared. They were deceitful. They lied to us. They lied to us, church. I thought, oh, man. Got it on lockdown. They lied to us. I was getting ready to build bigger barns, Mike. You fool, your life is required of you this night. What does a man profit if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? What's he saying? Keep your eyes on heaven and not the world. And sometimes it's not easy to do, church. Sometimes because we live in this world, right? We are in it, we're not of it. And I'm talking about worldly thinking, not people. We never condemn people, ever. I don't care where they're from. I don't care what they believe. I don't care from what country. We never condemn people, including the woman caught in adultery. Can I get an amen? What do? We present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Every man? Every man. Colossians chapter 1. Do your homework. Don't take my word for it. If you take my word for it, you're in trouble. Don't do it. Search it out, man. Maybe you'll find another mystery. Maybe you'll find a mystery that you might want to share with me. Good. Find it. What, God's only going to talk to me? And he's talking to anybody else in here? I think it's also Galatians that says that, but God forbid that I should glory save the cross of our Savior, Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified to me and I unto the world. What should you glory in? You should glory in nothing but the cross. You should hold on to nothing but the cross. You should have nothing greater in your life but the cross of Jesus Christ, by whom the world was crucified to me. What effect does the world have on me? None. It's crucified. It's dead. And what effect do I give or provide to the world? None. None. I have nothing to offer the world. I'll offer them heaven. I'll offer them the kingdom. I'll offer them mysteries of heaven. The world itself, I have nothing to offer that situation. Didn't remember the brother, he came to Jesus, he said, my brother's got this inheritance, Lord, and he won't share it with me. Mike's got that, my dad's inheritance, and he won't share it with me. What did Jesus say? What am I, a divider, an arbiter? What do you want me to do about it? What do you want me to do about it? But we do. We live our lives in the world, and we want what's fair and equitable. No? Just the corporate guy up here? What's fair and equitable? Nothing. Nothing is fair and equitable. Why? Because I got my cares of this world, and I took my eyes off of heaven. And instead of me worrying about my relationship with my brother, I want to argue and fight over a few dollars my father maybe gave him. Jesus is like, what, are you losing your mind? That's your brother, man. You want to fight and argue over some money? Maybe your father thought he needed it more than you. Maybe your father, maybe he owed it to him. Maybe, who cares? But we get caught up in the affairs of this world, in this life, in this world, and what we want to do is we want to win. Or we want to, maybe we don't, again, we just want it to be what we consider fair and equitable. Fair and equitable is different in everybody's mind right now, today. Even if I said, hey, let's be fair and equitable, it's still, what I think is fair and equitable is not what you think is fair and equitable. It isn't. So no one's ever going to meet that measure. What's the measure? The measure's Christ. Lay it down. Amen. The measure's Christ. Lay it down. Don't give up your relationship over some money, over an inheritance. You're willing to just dump it? You don't understand the mysteries of God. You don't understand the mysteries of the kingdom. You are now caught up in the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches. And it doesn't have to be money all the time, church. I know we gravitate there because we're just, well, me, I'm a knucklehead. But it doesn't have to be money. It can be ideas. It can be beliefs. It can be situations. It can be positions. It can be anything. Anything that you think enriches you. Maybe it's your degree. Maybe it's, hey, I've worked so many years at this job. Or maybe I worked so many years in this relationship. It's kind of like the entitlement. Church, those that are in Christ Jesus, there is no entitlement. Your entitlement is Christ. That's what you're you know what you're entitled to? Christ. Is it good enough for you, or you want something more? Is getting Christ enough, or are you entitled to something more than, what's more than Christ? You see what I'm saying? This is the character of this world, and yet we'll fight and argue. We'll do it in our own families. Never mind the church, and it's in the families. Remember, it was the brother that got the inheritance. Families will be split over that stuff. They'll be split over what mom left the teapot for what kid. Now, I know Vanessa don't want the teapot. Nicole probably does, but that's okay. Over a teapot. Where's Christ in that? Where's the mysteries of the kingdom in that? You just lost your seed. You're unfruitful. Verse 20. And these are they which are sown on good ground. Oh, thank God for the good ground. Church, I thought I was in quicksand there for those first few verses. Lord Jesus, get me out. We got some good ground. Such as hear the word and receive it. And it bring forth fruit. Some 30, some 60, some 100-fold, and, you know, we'll twist that. If you give so much, then you get 30-fold. If I give a real lot, I get 100-fold. Church, I gave a real lot. I never got 100-fold. I actually lost more than I got. I don't think that principle works. And again, I just see the 30, the 60, the 100. I just see it's Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. I just see it's the maturing. It's the progression of our life, if you will. And at the same time as that shell's coming off of the egg, eventually it'll just be pure white and perfect, and it'll be 100-fold. It'll be nothing but Christ. What's the 100%? I mean, it's not your bank account, church. Newsflash, I don't know what you got in there today. Likely going to have less next week if you're going to go shopping or spend some money. You know, unless one of you guys hit the pick three. Don't forget the offering if you do. Actually, I don't care what you do. God's been good to me. Oh, man. When I'm a child, I'm 30% like Christ. I get a little older, I'm like 60% like Christ. At some point, we got to become 100% like Christ, man. What's the good soil? It's heaven. It's heaven. It's faith. It's faith. I trade all of those crazy thoughts I have in my head that are accusing or condemning or judgmental or offended. I trade them all and I say, no, I have faith. I delight to do thy word. You know, as I read through this, I thought of the first psalm. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of the sinner, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his word he doth meditate both day and night. And I shall be like a tree planted by the river of living waters. And in his season he will bring forth fruit, and his leaf will not wither. And whatsoever I do in this life, it will prosper. It will prosper. Why? Because I won't counsel with the ungodly. The ungodly thoughts, the ones that say something other than Christ. I won't stand in the way of the sinner. What's that? I won't take pride and say, I'm not moving from my position. Church, you gotta move. Scripture's clear, man. You gotta move. And God forbid we sit down in that judgment seat and start declaring who gets and who don't, who's right, who's wrong. You don't know Scripture. You don't know Scripture. I, the Lord, create light. I create darkness. I create peace, I create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. Who created darkness and evil in your life? God Almighty. Why? Because he doesn't afflict willingly. And it wasn't to grieve your spirit. Contrary, it was so you would take your eyes off of this foolish, worldly thinking and start looking at heaven and understanding the greatness of our God. Amen. That's why. It's a mystery, church. I don't get it. Like, God's rules, we'll never get them. We'll never understand them. It's okay. I think we'll get insights and understanding in terms of what he expects us to do and what he is doing in our life to fully comprehend all of his mysteries. Impossible. Impossible. That's why the soil has got to be good soil. It's got to be faith-based. It's got to be in heaven. And for what purpose is all of this? Let's take a look at another mystery, Ephesians. Actually, let's take a look at Ephesians chapter 3 first. Which again, you want a powerful book on the sovereignty of God? Sovereign means he's in control of everything. Read Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 9. And to make all men, how many men? Isn't it amazing how many times that word shows up in the Bible? And isn't it amazing how, if you think back, you're like, how did I miss that? Am I the only one that, like, how did I miss that? I don't know. I'm always blown away by that. All men see what is the fellowship of the mystery. You mean we're supposed to be in fellowship? That's a mystery? Maybe that's why I'm not supposed to curse you and accuse you and judge you and spit on you and reject you. You mean it's supposed to be a fellowship that's supposed to be, that's a mystery? Is that what we're doing here? Is that what God's really after? The simplest is what God's after. He don't need you to go to India and preach the gospel or whatever. He don't. Now, he may call you. I'm not that. You know what he's after? He's after fellowship. Amen. You with him, and then you with everybody else. How many men? All men. All is all, church. I know this. Nobody in your life you would not fellowship with. You would never give anybody the Heisman in your life, no? I mean, come on, church. I think it's Proverbs says that the righteous desires to do good, the wicked wrath. Either we're going to desire to do good and have fellowship and love one another, or we're just going to be angry at each other. Which one is it? Well, if we'll operate with the mysteries of the kingdom of God, we'll do that. Which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Christ Jesus. The word things, it's pos, it's humanity, it's mankind, that word. When you see things, like, what things do you think he's talking about? Your, the dishes in your cupboard? This is the King James kind of conundrum here. Christ, everything is created in Christ Jesus, you and I. Everything is in Christ. Everything is formed in Christ. There's nothing that's not been formed in Christ. Jesus told the disciples about this. When you look and you look to find something in each other, what you should find is Christ. Why? Because I put it there. This is the mystery. This is the mystery. Amen? To the intent that now unto principalities and powers in heavens, in heavenly places, might be known by the church and the manifold wisdom of God. And what are the powers and principalities? Again, it's here. It's living by faith. Your principalities, it's talking about the kingdoms and the rulers. It's right here. I don't have any kingdoms and rulers other than what's upstairs in my head, church. But it's made known. It's made known, what? Through a lifestyle. Through a lifestyle. Ephesians chapter 5. For we are members of his body, of his flesh and his bones. Who? We, the church. We are members of his body. Flesh and bone, not flesh and blood. Flesh and blood doesn't inherit the kingdom of God. What is that? That means my stupid thoughts that accuse, that judge, that reject people, that doesn't inherit the kingdom. What does flesh and bone, mercy and truth? It's a picture, church. Mercy and truth. Remember, not one of his bones was broken when he hung on that cross, amen? It's a picture. Why? Because truth doesn't break. You can't break truth, which is truth right here. I know how I feel. That gets broke. You know why? Because you offend me. It's broken. Truth doesn't. Truth says that there's Christ in you, there's Christ in me. I won't be broken over that. Instead, I'm going to want the fellowship, the mystery of this fellowship. It's a mystery. I'll give you that. It's a strange fellow. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother, and he shall be joined unto his wife, and the two shall be one. Who shall be one? Christ and the church. This is the mystery. He goes on and says that, I think, in the next verse, actually. Yeah, this is the great mystery, not a regular mystery. The other ones are regulars. This is the great one. You want to know what the greatest is? It's right here in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 32. This is the great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. What? They're one. Like, who do you think you get to reject? Who do you think you get to throw sticks at and judge and curse and bring rallying accusation? None. All men is all men. This is the great mystery. This is the great mystery. We ought to be one. And oneness, isn't that the prayer in John 17? Father, may they be one as we are one. What do you think he was talking about? Christ and the church. The only way we're going to do that, mercy and truth, though. Mercy and truth. And I believe that's what Calvary did, church. It's a mystery how we did it all. I don't know if we'll ever solve all of it or understand all of it, but it's a mystery. And even when that Roman soldier tried to, is he really dead? And he stuck him with the spear, right? Well, poured out of that body of Christ, water and blood. It's a picture, birth. He gave birth to the church, water and blood. Same thing as the flesh and bone, mercy and truth. Like, what's going to pour out of Jesus Christ other than mercy and truth? Nothing. John chapter 1 says that's all he's filled with mercy and truth. So what could pour out of him? Nothing. Mercy and truth. Now, if we're one with him, shouldn't that be the same thing that pours out of us? Maybe that's like the tree that's planted by the rivers of living water. Matter of fact, doesn't Revelation 22 talks about the river coming out of the throne room of God? It's flowing. It's healing all the nations. What do you think would heal all the nations? Yeah, mercy and truth. Mercy and truth. It's a mystery. Let me ask the worship team if they'll come. It's a mystery. Each and every day is a mystery, I believe. Your life, your days, it's all a mystery. But I know, according to Scripture, God says he's already predestined it all and laid it all out and has a plan for you and I. And in the meantime, what do? We present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. And then we look to fellowship. That is the great mystery, when we become one. What, we become one with Christ and not with each other? That's not the kingdom. That's not the kingdom. The kingdom is we become one. We get rid of the stony ground. We get rid of, Satan coming and accusing. We get rid of the thorns that attack us. And we just keep our eyes set on the good ground, the good soil, which is heaven in Christ Jesus. Amen? Why don't you stand while we close out?